France, les barricades mystérieuses, the mysterious barricades. So mysterious, in fact, that after 300 years, no one really knows what that piece is about. I have my own theory, but I'm not going to go into that. That Brahms was truly a Renaissance man, and I think that some of his influences are perhaps better known than others. So, for example, it's well known that in his day, he was thought of as the heir to Beethoven's legacy. It's also well known that he was influenced by Hungarian music, right? And his collaboration with Josef Joachim. It's known that he edited and admired the works of Chopin and Weber. And so there's all these influences, but one influence that I think is perhaps underestimated is his encyclopedic knowledge of the Baroque. And not only J.S. Bach, but also Handel and Couperin. And he co-edited the 27 orders of Couperin's harpsichord music, which hundreds and hundreds of pieces. So I learned about that only in the last year or so, and I thought that's incredible because not only did he have a sort of passing knowledge of his music, he actually knew every note that Couperin wrote. And as you can hear in that piece, it's a very distinctive style. You could never mistake it for another composer. Incidentally, Couperin was born 350 years ago this year. And so it's amazing to discover in his works so many surprises. And one of the reasons why I wanted to play that and just bring up the topic is because I think the Handel variations that I'm going to play have something in common with Couperin's harpsichord pieces, which is they're not only dances, there are dances. There's recognizable the allemands and the gigues and sarabands, etc., etc. But the vast majority of Couperin's harpsichord pieces are portraits or caricatures. They are inspired by real people, and each of them stands on their own as well as functioning in a larger cycle, in the order. He calls them orders, I think, for a reason. Unity is a major consideration in their composition. And so I hear some of the variations that Brahms wrote in this piece almost like that. They almost stand alone, like a little character piece. They're not, in other words, they're not all dependent on what comes before and what comes after. Some of them are. You'll hear that there are groups that flow right one to the next, and others that are more kind of independent. Brahms was very proud of this piece, and he said that one of the things that he really looked for when considering a theme for a set of variations is not only the melodic possibilities, but also the nature of the bass, the bass line. The bass line was really what he felt was this fertile ground from which he could build a structure like this, which is 25 variations and a fugue. It's kind of a phenomenal achievement. I think even more phenomenal than that is that there's not a trace of the academic in it. It all flows very organically, and somehow he's able to combine all these different styles, which are nods to various composers and times and places, in a way that is somehow completely unified by the end of the piece. You sort of have this sense of the whole thing laid out before you, and it's kind of a compendium of Brahms' influence, especially from the Baroque. So I thought I would just introduce the theme a little bit and some of its properties. And the nice thing is that because of the structure of this piece being in these rather short variations, some things will be immediately apparent, more so than in the Chopin Sonata, for example. And I thought, for future reference for myself, if the Brahms Handel variations are the lighter portion of the program, I need to do something different. So here's the bass line. Similar kind of pattern. chamber music kind of sound in this first one. But you can hear the bass line itself. It's very plain, kind of unsophisticated. And then... Now he's going to take that a step further in the next variation, and... Very melodic ones. I think number 11 reminds me a little bit of the Couperin that I started the second half with. So many of them I think are quite self-explanatory. I want to call your attention to number 13 because I think that's one of the more substantial and independent of the variations. This is a kind of Hungarian, almost funeral march, which is one of the reasons why I thought I would pair this piece with the first half. It's in this low register, much like the Chopin, and also Couperin was very fond of this baritone register. He liked the sort of the warmth and color of this register that's darker than if it had been set up here. So this Hungarian variation sounds like this. One of my favorite juxtapositions that one in Variations in general, and then it's the one that follows it. Number 19 is Marto Leggero e Vivace, and this is one of the most overtly Baroque. I think this could actually be this could have been written by a Baroque composer. It's a kind of drone bass, and in this case I think it sounds very much like a music box.
Thank you.
slow motion halftime. Subject as he can, while adding these bell tones. So you'll hear in first the right hand. Astonishing what was possible in these old forms. So I hope you enjoyed Brahms' Handel variations.
Thank you. Thank you.
here, for Nick and to the Ross McKee Foundation for inviting me. I'll say goodnight with a short piece by François Couperin. This is a piece called Les Jumelles, Twins.
Thank you.
Beethoven's funeral march from his Sonata in A-flat, opus 26. Incidentally, also Chopin's favorite Beethoven sonata, the one that he played and taught most frequently. It's been written for decades that Chopin's B-flat minor sonata, which is going to be the subject of the first half of tonight, is modeled after this Beethoven sonata. And you can see why. Many of you will already have in your ear the famous and iconic funeral march of the Chopin sonata that I'm going to play. And you can hear that there's a lot of similarities between that and the Beethoven that I just played. What is the nature of a funeral march? And what is its significance in a piano sonata? First of all, I should say that Beethoven's sonata is then followed by maybe an even greater example in terms of magnitude in the Eroica symphony. So there's something very important going on for him with the form of the funeral march. And yet, it's maybe a little bit surprising here in the context of a sonata. This takes the place of what would normally be a slow movement. And sure enough, it is a slow movement, but it doesn't function like many of the other more lyrical pieces that we think of in Beethoven's sonatas that provide relief in the tension, to the tension of the outer movements. In this sonata, it has a very unusual opening, which is a set of variations. And followed by a scherzo, the funeral march is third, and then there's a perpetuum mobile, last movement, the sort of scurrying thing that is very watery and brilliant. It's like a toccata. And so I think that the significance of the funeral march is interesting in the sense of memory, in the sense of cultural memory. What's the function of it has something to do with helping process grief in a very public way. And I think it has everything to do with repetition, because the nature of something that is tragic requires repetition to process. It's something that is too incomprehensible for our system to take at one go. And so you hear the repeated notes, the same rhythm, this sort of dirge over and over. Chopin's sonata than maybe is previously understood. Chopin has always the craftsmanship of a Beethoven, of a Bach, and yet it's usually not on display as topic. It's normally woven in with such subtlety that the listener, and even sometimes the pianist, is not aware of it. There are countless examples of hidden canons, inner voices, counterpoint, all different kinds of techniques that show this master craftsman, and yet the impression that we're most often left with Chopin's music is one of improvisation, this operatic gift for melody, just spinning long melodies all over the place, and a kind of facility and virtuosity of elegance. And so to have a piece like the sonata that I'm going to play that absolutely makes the motivic elements of it the topic, it's unavoidable. You're confronted with it in the most obsessive and inelegant way. There's something going on there because that's what Beethoven does. He forces the issue, right? And so before I get into the Chopin itself, I want to play one more excerpt of a Beethoven sonata, a different Beethoven sonata, that deals with loss. And I was playing through this yesterday and I thought, no, I have to talk about this because I think there's something important going on here. This is Opus 81A, Beethoven sonata in E-flat, just published with the subtitle Les Adieux, in German Das Lebewohl. Beethoven actually marks the three syllables, one syllable on each note of this opening. And it means something like farewell, fare thee well. Simone, because I think there's something really amazing happening. This sonata is in E-flat, so if I were to play the way it should sound at the beginning, it would sound like this. That's home. And so Beethoven does a deceptive cadence here at the beginning with these horn calls. This business of flat six, six being here very close to home, a relative minor. Six is very far away, flat six. And it necessitates this note, which is the minor version of our home key. So those are linked, right? So if I play home, minor, I can easily get to flat six. Okay. Now what that means in the larger context of the piece is that the raising of that interval, which has been lowered, means salvation. So you see that as a topic of discussion through this piece. The other thing I want to point out is the idea of a three-note motive that spans a third. You've heard it in these horn calls, right? It could be simpler. And he goes over this many, many times in different iterations, including this sort of imitative. What he does at the end there, there's been this relationship between that we've been talking about. Well, he goes over and over and over again to the C, the raised six, right? This is the one that brings us back home. Farewell or departure. Listen to how he takes the three-note motive and transforms it. Now, instead of three notes down, one note down, and one jumping above the first one. Thank you. the third movement, which is the return. It's a very joyous and brilliant finale that resolves all the conflict of the first two movements. Now, why am I spending so much time on a Beethoven sonata when I'm going to talk to you about the Chopin second sonata? Well, I think that Chopin must have known this piece because there are an awful lot of similarities between the writing and his second sonata, which is really his first sonata. His early sonata that he refers to, his early sonata, Opus 4, is not really representative of him as a mature composer. And so the second sonata, the B-flat minor that I'm going to play, is really his first mature essay in the form. And there are just too many similarities between that and Beethoven, even in terms of figuration. Beethoven writes... Symmetrical phrases, right? These groupings of three and five. The threes feel too short and the fives feel too long. And this is going through the whole movement. What he does in the development is quite extraordinary because he combines all the elements at the same time. So you have, on the one hand, this agitato, obsessive motive. Thank you. think that if you take the repeat in the exposition, you don't need to hear it again. So he goes right on to the second theme in the home key. And one other thing I wanted to point out, that relationship between flat six and the raised six, the regular sixth. I think the roles are reversed in this piece. In Beethoven's Sonata, the flat six leads home. And in Chopin's, it doesn't. Because the way that he's able to resolve this is with the flat six in a major key. Obsessive nature of the theme and goes even further. Now it's just straight repeated notes. Apparently the march was written first, the trio was written separately. Both of those predate the rest of the sonata. The rest of the sonata is actually constructed from the funeral march itself. I'm jumping a little bit to the finale, which is one of the strangest few pages of music in Western classical music. Mm-hmm. And this is why I say I think Chopin goes off in a different direction. Because where Beethoven, after the absence, has this glorious return, instead of after the funeral march having that kind of resolution, he raises that flat six, which seems so oppressive. And Chopin then raises that to. Played this, the ending is always I think partially because of the sheer pessimism and very direct kind of confrontation with the darkness of the funeral march. There is no resolution. And I think that's one of the things that shocked the audiences of the day. Even Schumann, who was such a great advocate for Chopin, said, this sonata is nothing more than his four wildest children bound together. But in fact, I think it's a very, very great sonata. It's, of course, stood the test of time. And I think it's a good example of how Chopin kind of molds a form to his own purposes. And so I would just encourage you, as you listen to it now, to think of the funeral march as its basic kind of embryonic form that has then been extrapolated to the other movements, the obsession, the repetition, and then this relationship of the sixth degree, particularly when it appears in the major.
Thank you. Thank you.